good. I'm good. I got it.
Great job.
Thank you very much. Thank you.
I don't want to get too comfortable in case somebody decides to rearrange our thing.
I didn't want anybody too close. You could spit on us.
This is loud. Hello? Ooh. Deb Morrison and a mic. This is good. Okay, folks, if everybody could find a seat and... I don't know. Maybe our CMIT people, I think they thought it was going to be filmed. Is that right? Yes. Then yes, it is going to be filmed. Hi, folks. We're going to start in about 30 seconds. We'll get... Bless your heart. Well, you know, it might be a little later. It might be 32 seconds since we're waiting on Glenn. We're waiting on Glenn, so it may be 32 seconds, okay. Right?
It's okay.
Ladies, come up here. Take the mic off for a moment.
Wow, that can't be the first question. That cannot be.
Yeah, let's take off. This row, at least. Would you? Yeah. Okay, this party's about to start. Hi, folks. Let's grab a seat. Good morning. Thank you for being here in our to witness a wonderful moment, our centennial panel on the future of advertising and public relations. To gather this many people in a room and this much star power up front means that we'll all be taking notes for the final, you know that. Extra points on everything for all of us. For being respectful and quiet, et cetera. I know some of you may need to leave for a 10 o'clock class. If that's the case, go quietly, right? We'll do this together. But I'm glad you're here, and welcome everyone, and all of our wonderful JAC folks and you guys. The Hall of Achievement dinner last night was amazing, and many of us were there, so some of us are kind of looking like the prom was last night, and this is the SAT this morning. And what were we thinking when we scheduled this? So bear with, maybe we'll take off some of this. Bear with us on, you know, there might be a few chairs we can bring in to the side. Bear with us on voices and being a little bit gravelly here and there.
Just take the tape off. There's a row up front. Jen, you can come up front.
We'll take the tape off.
You just have to promise not to throw it.
This is a up close and personal moment. Let's move it, yeah. Thank you, Jed. We'll get ourselves all settled here. So I think the great moment here is that we have a panel of six people who any one of them could command a keynote speech anywhere in the world for thousands of people. So what we're getting there is sort of an unbelievable exponential set of wisdom. We're going to use time wisely. And they're going to get to talk. If we come to the end and we have time for two student questions, we'll do that, so make them good. Right now, I want to introduce amazing friends, partners, and stars in the world. Glenn Cole, right over there, is the co-founder and chief creative officer of 72 and Sunny. And you know what I love most is the sense of you making, you and your team, the big you, making culture happen within the organization. And that's always referred to, so yay on that. I asked them to introduce them because the introductions could take hours, what they're most proud of. And he had a couple of things. Of course, family is always up there, but also that he was on the track team here at Oregon, yay.
I was proud that I survived it. I don't think I was proud of that. I was proud of making it.
And the overwhelming fact that 72 is that place that we all look to see what's being invented and appreciated there. Pat Curtin, hi, is one of our esteemed endowed professors here at the university. And I love that she took her undergraduate degree in religion and philosophy at a Quaker university. Whoa. That's sort of amazing. And again, lots to talk about in terms of her professional and academic experience. But she cites family and the fact that her professional life is about building students and having them go out and I think you said kick butt, but it could be kick ass too. So that's amazing. Thank you. Dana Wade, who your renowned moment of being management and strategy in such places as Spike DDB or Sparks and Honey, and now at Red Fuse, and looking at the direction of data and strategy and huge moments. I love that. That is so amazing. And you're proud of being part of a family of vision-driven people who set goals and achieve them. That's awesome. Thank you for being here. Amazing Scott Bedbury. I think that's trademarked, Amazing Scott Bedbury. graduated in 80, is the brand whisperer that we all understand and know for Nike, for Starbucks, for the U.S. Navy. I always like to put that in there, the wonderful work you did for them. And a catalyst for thinking about optimism and purpose in our respective fields. I had just a close moment about getting what you're proud of, and I know it's your family. It's Nick and Allie and what they're accomplishing out there. And he always makes me cry as he goes into the family moment. So if you do that, remember that I'll be weeping. Corey duBrowa, yay, class of 88, and now at Starbucks as the senior VP Global Communications, but has been at Nike and at Edelman. We have some themes here of Nike, Starbucks, you know, all over the place, right? proud of your work and your accomplishments, but once again, proud of your kid. You know, there's something about the real things in life that when we see that kind of pride, that's amazing. And he may be joining us here at the university. Okay, so we're doing that. And then the inimitable Tracy Wong, class of what, 81? The founder of Wong Duty. And he has, if you've heard him talk, he'll tell you all the wonderful things that Wong Duty has been called over the years. But an amazing career dedicated to creativity, dedicated to great ideas, dedicated to the democracy of ideas. There's a great title for a book. And the shared joy of that process. And family, again, cited, but certainly, and I love this, he said one of the things he's proud of for 20 years, making payroll for an agency staff and keeping that together. That's an accomplishment. So as we go on, think about who you have in the room here and appreciate them. We're going to be talking broadly about optimism, but within that, we want to get pragmatic. We want to have some real ideas about what that means and about the challenges that we have to meet in order to go forward. We're going to think about the overlap of the two respective programs that we look at here. But out in the world, there aren't big lines drawn between advertising and public relations. So we're going to talk a little bit about that. I'm going to start with one question that I'll ask all of you to address, and then I'll give them a specific question, and you'll hear from them again, and then we'll see where we're at with time. Again, take notes. All of it's on the final, right? The final is life.
Oh.
And so that's why we're here, right? So every class is dedicated to the final. So they have to take all notes. And that means that all of us are doing that. So, folks, in this chaotic and evolving world with multiple challenges that our culture faces and that our disciplines, our fields face, challenges about diversity and technology and privacy and environment and consumerism and transparency, with all of those things, are you optimistic about the future of the field, and why? Glenn, you start.
Sorry, okay. Yeah. Sorry, I got called out by the teacher first. I'm the young one. Still in the 90s, I guess.
Already throwing shade.
It's not going well.
Already throwing shade.
You can
shade.
Drop your mic over yet. There, right? Yeah.
Now I have to answer that. Look, I feel like, I talked about this last night, but obviously the world's changing faster. It's more obvious to us because we've been in this industry for 20 plus years, and you can see that the change is accelerating. I feel like the last 4 or 5 years has changed faster than the first 15 years and probably 40 years before that. And I feel like next year, I have no idea what next year will bring. But I just find that really exciting. I think it means there's more white space, there's more canvases, you know? I feel like half the job now is not trying to vet talent for how they think or craft in a medium we understand. Half the time, I'm vetting them for I'm trying to learn about the medium that they're going to educate me on or our brands on, and that's just really exciting. It puts me in a learning orientation again, and I think when you're in a learning orientation, you can't help but be optimistic. It feels like all you see is potential, and so I'm stoked about it.
So the learning continues.
Yeah.
And it always has, but now there are even more great learning moments, I think, as we continue.
It feels like it's nonstop learning right now.
Yeah.
Almost, that's probably the only downside. It's borderline overwhelming, but, you know, Vine's gone, so that's one less thing to.
Yeah.
R.I.P. Vine.
There's some cool people on Vine. R.I.P.
Pat?
I'm going to speak more to the public relations side because that's my area of expertise, and I don't want to trump on the much better expertise of the ad side present here. And yeah, it's an incredible time to be in PR. latest report just came out and said global growth for agencies is going to be more than 33% over the next 5 years. Hmm. That's explosive. Even corporations are talking 13% growth over the next 5 years. So it used to be we're returning out too many graduates to really place in good jobs. Now it's can we turn out enough graduates to fill the demand who have all the wonderful skills that are needed. Hmm. And it's also a case of, it used to be we'd tell students, oh, well, you know, hang on. When folks are ready to hire, they'll hire. You probably won't get your first job until sometime later in the summer. Now our students are getting jobs before they graduate. They know exactly what they're going to step into. And what we're finding is in public relations now, we're taking off to where we are taking over functions that used to be management functions. HR is becoming PR. And in fact, reporting directly to the CEO or director of an organization. So yeah, as far as I'm concerned, what an exciting time to come into this field.
Yeah, wow. We're seeing that too, and again, our overlaps, we're gonna talk about that later, our overlaps are just as robust as some of the differences that we see, but we're seeing people being hired before they graduate or right as they graduate. Yeah, wonderful. Dana?
I'm actually really optimistic, too. I don't know that there's anybody not optimistic about the time that we live in with so much white space being created, so many amazing new ideas fueled by technology. It just creates just growth, personal growth, which is important. It fuels our intellectual abilities. I think our industry for many, many years was fairly stagnant in terms of its intellectual capabilities and growth. We were always growing from an idea standpoint, from a creative standpoint, but our strategic focus and our intellectual growth and our curiosity seemed to me for many years to be a little bit stagnant. So now we're in a space where we have to accept the fact that we are not the smartest people in the room, none of us anymore, because somebody knows one new fact, and somebody else knows another new fact. Somebody else knows about a new startup that's targeted to be the next big disruptor. And everyone is having to come together and work together to solve solutions, or create solutions that are outside of the box, undefined, charting new paths in real time, all the time, at the same time. And so I think that just creates a great opportunity for higher levels of engagement, higher opportunities for creative thinking, and I think just great opportunities for growth for individuals and for students. You guys are going to walk into a space that's undefined, and it can't be better than that.
In your talk last night, it reminded me, too, we talk a lot about the hybrid, the hyphenate, you know, coming out of school with a set of different skills. You might call yourself one thing, but you have all of this, and that's different than it was before.
Oh, yeah.
It used to be very pillared, siloed, and you came out as this. So it is remarkable what, remarkable, chaotic, confusing.
Exciting. Because of all that.
Right.
But I'm a little twisted, so I don't like to.
Well, there's a lot of twist in here, because I mean, I certainly, and I hate the M word, but let's use it. Millennials are looking at that idea of that's exciting to them. There are multiple ways they can use their talents.
Yep.
So yeah, yay.
Sure. Am I optimistic? I think is the question about the future. I would say unabashedly yes. The realist in me is also pretty pessimistic about a lot of what I see. I do see a lot of pessimism. I see a lot of people, young and old, pulling back and maybe blaming other people for what's in play. There's nothing good in that, obviously. And I think I see a lot of people that are entering into what I call companies moving into what was just said here, stagnancy, you know, and a lot of risk aversion. And I don't know where risk management became risk aversion. I'm not quite sure how that happened. There's never been a better time to take a risk than right now. When industries are stagnant, that's a time for someone to step up and reinvent it. One of my clients is Airbnb. You guys are probably familiar with them. You know, they created an entirely new category out of things laying around your home, a couch, you know, or a bedroom. And there are many more opportunities like that. You know, yes, call it a unicorn. Will there be another Airbnb? Maybe, I don't know. But my point is, the hotel industry has been around a long time, and they've kind of lost track of what a great travel experience is about. Same with Starbucks. You know, there's a 900-year-old category given up for dead in the United States. We did our first focus groups in 95, and consumers filed in, and we said, hey, we're going to spend the next 2 hours talking about coffee, and they all groaned. It's like, oh, God, really? Remember one group in Santa Monica said, can we talk about sneakers? Thought that was ironic, given where I'd come from. But you guys don't know this. Most of you probably weren't even around then, but in 95, I bet 3% of the U.S. population could pronounce cappuccino correctly. I think Starbucks in 95 maybe had 400 stores, a couple dozen markets. And what we did is we went to the emotional territories, which I think is where you go when there really nothing seems to resonate anymore. So look into your own heart, look at consumers, and say, when this, in this case coffee, insert product here, whatever it is, when it's as good as it can be, it can't be any better, can't be any more meaningful, can't be any more prolific or noble, what the hell is happening in that moment? And reverse engineer back. So we, instead of talking about 17 origin countries and 18 to 23 second espresso shot times, and we called it romancing the bean, you know, back then in the beginning, they had posters in the stores of the difference between a cappuccino and a latte, like an engineer's drawing, how much milk and foam.
We've grown a little.
Yeah. But we actually just did a simple amount of deep dive in research, and honestly, it was sort of, we all kind of instinctively knew it, but it's good to hear consumers talk about it. Even those who'd never been in a coffee house were articulating what a great coffee experience is, and it wasn't being delivered. So we delivered them. So I think going out into the industry now, I'm almost envious of you guys. You got a lot of people sitting around blaming somebody else, risk averse, waiting for real leaders to step up. And I know it's going to be hard as the youngest one on the team, right? But I'll tell you, I hired a lot of young people at Nike and Starbucks. At Nike, most of them were right out of Oregon. I was slightly biased. 22, 23 years old. A lot of them went on to become vice presidents. And I think management, maybe we can talk about that again later in terms of how a young person makes his way in an organization, especially as big as like Starbucks today. As a leader, as a former manager of a bunch of people, I look for people that are resilient in times of difficulty, people that can adapt, people willing to do whatever they got to do to kind of help you move. Because nobody knows, to the earliest comment here, it is uncertain. It's hard to say what the world looks like in 5 years, but it will reward those that are adaptive, that don't complain, that bring a little fun to work and lead, no matter what your job is.
Love it. Corey.
Hi, Deb. I'm going to entitle this Reasons to Be Cheerful 2016. Here we go.
How many?
First is that I think for a lot of us on the panel, we can speak to a time when we were making our way through our careers where there was this, the only way I can think to articulate it is apprenticeship, where somebody gave you a little tiny thing to do and you did it many, many times and you could prove that you could do that little tiny thing, and so you would get an incrementally slightly larger thing to do and do that for a while and prove you could do that. And if you sort of persisted in not making mistakes, eventually you would be able to contribute. And I think those days are over. I think they've been over for a long time. I think there is still an exchange rate that happens out in the, I'm going to hashtag this, the final is life. Hashtag the final is life. So out there in life, there is still a...
TM. Go ahead.
TM. T-shirt. There is still an exchange rate that happens, but it's not attached to a big, long runway or ramp. Of an apprenticeship program. We literally expect our newest hires to come in and contribute from day one. And you know, as many people on the panel have already said, we're learning as much from them as they're learning from us. But the exchange rate is still learning how to manage a business, learning how to navigate in a complex environment, learning how to work with clients. All of those are things that I think we can still teach, but it's really shortened up the runway. So my first reason to be cheerful is this apprenticeship thing, over. And I think that, you know, you all will be able to step in and contribute in ways that far surpassed anything that we did for a good long while. So that's thing one. Thing two, I'm going to seize on something Pat said. So when we say things like HR is PR, and I'll just speak to our business at Starbucks. So what we think about is the fact that last week, 90 million people came through our stores around the world. 90 million people. So that's either
90 million chances to get it right or wrong. And so the brand is not what I say. The brand is not an ad that we run. The brand is not a story that was in the Wall Street Journal or wherever you might have found it. The brand is the experience that you have as a customer, the behavior that you see with the person in the green apron sitting behind the counter, and the feeling that you have when you walk out. So if I'd been sitting here in your shoes back in the day and somebody had said, at some point, if you really do a good job, they're going to call you a chief behavior officer or something like that, that is actually what we do from a communications point of view. The best story is how you be. So we'll come back to that.
Third Another great hashtag, cheerful. How you be.
How you be.
TM.
TM. Okay. Third reason to be cheerful sits, or stands in this case, over here to my left. I have no idea if you guys know how lucky you are to be in a classroom with people like Deb, who are sort of willfully breaking apart all of these old goofus religious constructs about this thing and that thing that have persisted forever, and just kind of mashing all this stuff together, which is really how stories live in the wild. We don't think of them as that's an ad, or that's a story, or hey, we got a 2-minute short, or whatever. It is a narrative, it's a story. And so the other reason I'm cheerful is that I think the people who will reinvent our industry are sitting right here. I took a picture of y'all before we started, so I'm gonna come back and circle somebody. You know, you're the one who reinvented it. But it's people like Deb who are willfully sort of crashing through these barriers and helping to create the person who's gonna reinvent our industry, because you know what? We need it.
Thank you. That makes me so popular sometimes. I just want you to know. Now, that said, to your point, what I love most is when you take that picture, you don't know who the person is. So you play to everybody in the room, and everybody's lifted. Oh, I love that. Chills. Okay. Tracy.
How am I supposed to go now?
You know you can. So you know you can. You go.
I'm going to really simplify it. We're creative people. We are optimistic by nature. That's just the way we are. It's like it's breathing and running and moving. So I find that that's not really a question. It's just a state of being. As I look back on the past few years and what has really changed, technology has fucked up everything. And it's made it really great and interesting. But what is really interesting about that, I think, is that technology is a tool. It's like a hammer. It's like a wheel. And what we do, creativity, is the hand that uses that tool. And that hasn't changed yet. And I know I got my first question, so I'm going to address that a little bit more. But that's really pretty much it. It's like what we do, creativity, does not change. It's not, you just keep going. So any creative person is relentless. That's just our survival mode. You just keep going. So it's our nature.
Love, yes. Wonderful. One of the big goals of this morning is to take away things, and Pat and I have talked about this, take away things that might end up as workshops or as seminars or as a guest lecture or as a book or a Broadway musical. Who knows what it'll be, right? And so I want you guys to be keeping score on that and have your suggestions. And at the end, after we have a couple more questions, I'd love you all to think about what would you see as the place to teach, the workshop, the seminar, the guest lecture you would give around these themes? I think we already have some.
Let's go Broadway musical. That seems the most interesting.
I know it. I love it. I know it. It could be done. You know it could be. So there it is. So crafting questions for these guys is like my final, right? That's kind of big. So let me ask a few. So Tracy, let's go back to you. And where you were going with that, some of the tools. So what are the great opportunities that you see in developing this? And in using these tools, even as, you know, that list of obstacles that we have, diversity. I want you to see in this room, there's a lovely set of diverse faces, technology, et cetera. So how do we use these great tools? What are they, and what do you offer them? About that.
All right, so great opportunities for creativity in the future. There is one great opportunity as we move into the future. If I look at, you know, what these guys were talking about, all the industries that technology has completely disrupted, technology has yet to disrupt creativity. So I have to say, for right now, the future is we get to keep our job. Deb and I talked about this before. I see sort of the biggest threat to creativity is artificial intelligence. And it hasn't happened yet. I've been waiting for this for decades. We will get replaced by algorithms. I almost hate to think about it, because our AI is developing exponentially. It's like Terminator, the Terminator agency. Steve Jobs once said that creativity is merely connecting things. And the thing that artificial intelligence cannot do yet is sort of that blend of relevance and randomness, that sort of artistic element of connecting things that were never connected before, creating new industries, thinking of ideas, crafting stories, whatever. So I feel like the great opportunity, again, is we get to keep our job. And always on the other end of whatever you're doing is another human. So, we talk a lot about storytelling, but if you really think about it, storytelling is so ancient. That is what is so great about it. That will not change. It's as ancient as the survival instinct, mating, eating. Those are all things. Tell me a story. Tell me a story around a campfire. That is as ancient as humankind. So to me, the issue is we get to keep our job. Let's try to stay out ahead of artificial intelligence. But on the other end, it's human.
You lost them at mating. They're all thinking about that right now. So. I know my people. I know my people, right? But it's true, and that whole sense of story and the idea that we no matter the program or the institutional part of this school, it's about story. And so if we're pushing in that regard, we're pushing on that sense of, I wrote that down, relevance and randomness, the idea, and that's our gold.
Connection.
Agreed.
Okay.
Dana. Your global view of optimism, last night, again, you spoke to that, and that was amazing. I love to think of you leading the charge in culture at Spike DDB and then moving to trends and design and data at Sparks and Honey, and now in your big data moment. So what is the optimistic, or maybe we take that word, what is the trend that you think, and you told us last night a lot of these, the trend that you think will really, really make the careers of these folks out here?
Well, I think the big thing that we all have to, and for the foreseeable future, really have to manage is distraction. And innovation leads to distraction. These wonderful tools, we're completely distracted by them all day, every day. Everybody walks around like this, right? But the intersection of distraction and actually getting something done is going to be difficult. Technology, as wonderful as it is, it's about churn, 2.0, 2.3, or 3.0, 4.0. It's always about the next iteration. Where are we now with our iOS system? 7? No, 10. We're at 10. So we're at 10 now, right? And there's going to be an 11, and there's going to be a 12, and there's going to be a 13. And it's constant change. With constant change, though, from a leadership perspective, right, because I'm assuming I'm talking to a room of future leaders, is that you have to navigate that, right? You have to be able to let innovation and distraction happen because there's growth in that, but you also have to have a really clear vision about where you're going, right? Because otherwise, with distraction, you're all over the place. You don't really get anywhere. I find that, I've had three different careers now, three different careers now. So I've consulted, I've done general advertising, I've done digital, now I'm doing big data, and I came from here. So people are like, how do you do data? I mean, like, are you a quantitative person? No, but I'm a thinking person, right? And so what does all that data and distraction tell us? You could get lost on it. There's so many people right now that you can't talk to about data, because they just sit there and they're like, what is she talking about? Why is she talking about data? Oh my God, that means I have to count. I don't want to count. I don't know how to count.
And bringing all that together from a leadership perspective is really going to be just absolutely critical. Right now, when you think about the global economy, the people who are winning are the people who have a clear vision, know where they're going, take all the disruption going on in the environment, and use it to their ability or to match their vision. So don't let distraction be the vision, but know what you're trying to do, and then go after it and incorporate those things that are moving industry forward in whatever you do.
Mm. Yeah, beautiful. Pat. So we often have discussions here in the school about how our classes, our programs overlap in advertising and public relations, even while we know that conferences and leadership and agencies and a lot of the perspective is separated, if nothing else, than by tradition, right? So where do you see us taking this sense of overlap and shared commitment to these goals? And what do we do? Give me an assignment. I ask you that on email just about every night. Tell me what to do, Pat.
First of all, I think what you've heard a lot about is a lot of our shared areas. You know, going into the future, what are we looking at? We're looking for diverse talent willing to experiment. That's you guys, okay? And that goes across the board. And diversity comes in many, many forms, not just ethnicity. So think about that.
This is a good soundtrack to what you're doing.
I know. And then an emphasis on social listening. You know, you heard Corey talking about that, this whole idea that we're all looking to how do we listen more? How do we get shared community building going? How do we get those enterprises off the ground? You heard about storytelling. We're all after content creation. Okay, everybody's looking, especially if you want to look at the overlap, that would be in terms of, I think, consumer lifestyle. Okay. Rethinking audiences, listening to how they self-define rather than defining them. That's going to be a big part of everybody's business going forward. And so when I teach the research class, I say, why do we have boxes for gender? Why don't we use survey forms now have a slider? Why not allow people to slide between male and female and let you know where they want to be identified?
Whoa.
So we have
another TM girl. That's great.
So we have new ways of going about this. Where are we not as shared? Because there are differences, okay? So a lot of renewed emphasis on internal audiences, which tends to be a little bit more the public relations side. Okay, how are we working to make our employees our biggest ambassadors for who we are? Okay, because if they're not on your side, you've already lost the battle. I'm sitting next to somebody who does big data and a lot of data mining on the advertising side. So I'm going to very carefully say that a lot of public relations work is what we used to call it environmental monitoring, now we call it landscape analysis because it's big, okay? But using a lot of public opinion data to feed into issues management, to be able to really see what's coming down the road and figure out what's going to be the next big issue that we need to anticipate, to deal with, and how are we going to handle that? And that's just a little bit different. Okay, and also all the areas outside of brands and consumer. So we need to think about the fact a lot of government, public relations, et cetera, that doesn't quite fall into the ad box. So we've got a lot of shared areas looking toward the future that we want to get to, but we tend to get there in slightly different ways. And so what happens is the last global report comes out, and what are the two skills they want PR majors coming out with? Writing is still number one. It has been number one, it remains number one. And so if you wonder why we put you through all those writing classes, it's because we want to make sure that you're ready to walk into those top jobs. Research is number two. And that's why we require the research class, because we want to make sure you guys hit the ground running. And the ability to do deep dive analytics is going to be crucial. So we have lots of great areas of overlap. How do we make that happen? I think it happens more at the upper reaches. I think when you're starting out, you kind of need to get your foot solid and where you're going. But then as you work through the major and you get those opportunities in things like AHA, AHPR, in terms of the ag competition, ag team, et cetera, those are some areas where we can get some really nice overlap and recognize the synergies.
Yeah, yay. We have lots of good work to do. That's terrific. Glenn? Again, 72 and Sunny, iconic in its sense of the culture helps drive the work, helps drive the culture, helps drive the work, who you bring in, fit, et cetera. So how does that happen organizationally? I know, yeah. So that's an essay question, right? But what do you do? It can't just say, we're going to have a great culture of optimism and modern thinking. You have to do things. And I know that the four partners work on that. I mean, you worry over it. You talk about it, and you worry. How does that work? What do you do?
this is the 9 a.m. session. All right. Well, we do worry about it. I think, you know, you wake up, I feel like a responsibility, or Tracy, I think, articulated well, to provide, create an ecosystem that will help people thrive and do things better than I could do them, or my partners could do them, where you guys, the best of you, can come out, or it pulls it out of you. And I don't know that I have the answer. If I did, I don't think we'd worry about it every Monday and Thursday morning, but there are a couple things we focus on, whether they work at other companies or not, I don't know. Optimism is that we have a couple core values, optimism being one of them. I mean, the name of the company is a statement of optimism, which is simply about choosing how to orient yourself towards whatever flaming chainsaw is coming your way at any given moment. And to do that requires, doing. I think you have to be doing it and making as much as you can, because doing is thinking, making is thinking. I really believe that. I read some quote last night in the book from Eric Allen that's similar to that. I was like, all right, 100-year-old principal at the school. and the good thing about when you just get making, and we try to do everything in the company to foster, just wake up, get in here and just start making right away. The good thing about making is, you stop navel-gazing, you stop wondering about the concept, you're staring at the ceiling. You just start letting your instincts take over. If you can invite other voices in to push on your ideas, then I think it becomes exhilarating. You start to create momentum, and that fuels, in turn, a sense of optimism, which makes you feel like, I want to do more. The things we do specifically, or some of the things we've done architecturally, like physically architecturally, and also just architecting the experience. We try to get, I don't know what happened here now, we try to get work out of people's laptops and phones and onto the wall as fast as possible. That's not so much to be like, keep printers in business, but that's just, there's a real benefit to seeing how somebody walking by just responds to that, you know, ambiently. You don't get the benefit of that when you're just down on your phone and put your post out, and then maybe likes or something. Who knows if that's an accurate representation of what somebody thinks about it. When it's at the wall, it's not yours, it's ours. It can benefit from everybody's input on it, putting pressure on it. I think it can weed out superficial stuff really quick. It can also point to the part of an idea that's the strongest that should be built on. It can point out anything. It can point out where it needs a voice. And I think in those environments, you know, one of the things that I get asked a lot in other school speaking things like this.
Wait, you go to other schools to speak?
Only one. Portland, University of Oregon, Portland Extension. There's a real skepticism about what I'm describing as like a collaborative process that leads to groupthink. And I totally get that fear, which it's a fear. So first of all, you got to acknowledge that's just fear. That's not real. And it's not about group thinking. It's just about bringing the best out of everyone around you to make an idea better. Like, if the idea is great, it will float to the top. You know, our job is just to put enough pressure on something to, like, push it up. So that's one thing we do at the company to try to foster, I guess, the culture we have. There are plenty of other values. I could busk for a while on them. But one thing I did want to say, that when it comes to hiring, like, the people who thrive there, I do think, you know, I think what's happening now more in the last few years, more than the previous years, because social media is so prevalent, is, you know, people in HR departments or recruiters, they are, like, definitely checking out your social profiles. So I hope you're thinking about what you're doing there. And I don't mean, like, get angsty about it and fearful and try to make it.
But be smart.
But heads up, that's a channel. You're a brand, and we're interested in seeing how you build your brand and what your voice is. You know, I was really inspired last night. Dean Moyota said one of his priorities for the company is, or it's not the company,
sort of
school. Probably good to start thinking like a company, because that's what it is. It's what you are. But is to help you find your voice. And I think those channels, we didn't have access to the channels like that. We all tried to do the best we could within, like, a print ad box. We were trying to sort of show what our voice was about. You guys have all these different ways to express yourself and find your voice and express your voice. But you should be, I think that's probably the most potent thing you've got right now to sort of position yourself going into the market. And that's something we put a lot of energy into looking at. Like, how does this person treat their own brand? Is that something that's going to translate when I've got to sit down with Corey and his team at Starbucks or any other client? So,
right. My favorite example is a young woman a few years ago who on Twitter explained how to hotbox a puppy.
Okay.
Yeah. It didn't go over well, let's just say. So that's a bad example, by the way. So write that down as the bad example. And to the creative process, that, you know, that's my area of both research and thinking about how to help people do that. And what we have found is that the white walls, the writable walls, have become such a huge extension of creative process that people do this, and then they go up there to be collaborative. So the fact that so many of you helped give us those white walls and push that, and so many of you use them in that way, that's remarkable. So, yes. So let's see, Corey, 90 million consumers, Howard Schultz as a beacon for purpose and for for looking at the world in ways that aren't expected many times and trying things. How do you help at such a huge, how do you drive and bring people on to the idea that such an important brand is optimistic? What goes on? Tell us your secrets.
Okay, sure, yeah. We're a public company, so we should do that. I think probably where I would start, it's just, I'm just sort of trying my best to channel the boss. Howard talks a lot about, and he's thought this way forever, so it's not like he woke up in 2016 and was like, Eureka, trust matters, you know, culture counts. But, you know, I think the company was always trying to build a different kind of company, one that could kind of balance this idea of humanity with the things that make us a public company, right? I mean, you know, we have a fiduciary responsibility to our shareholders, and so yes, you know, do we make money? Yes. Is that the reason we wake up every day? No. And he's said it a lot. And so building a reservoir of trust is really, that's job one. And you go back to our mission, right? You kind of think about the idea of, and I can just read it to you. Inspiring and nurturing the human spirit, one person, one neighborhood, one cup at a time. There's not a lot in there about, like, we're going to sell you coffee, you know? Nurturing and inspiring the human spirit. That's a different kind of thing to talk about at a high level for a company than, you know, we're going to ring up the till and try to sell 90 million people coffee. And so I think trust is really the thing that we're trying to do. And I'll use a specific example because I just think it's relevant. So we ran a campaign about a month ago called Upstanders. So I don't know how many of you have seen this. It's starbucks.com/upstanders. Thank you, that one person in the back. Cool.
There's two. There's another one.
Thanks for that. Shout out to the one person. Two people in the back. All right. What we were trying to do with Upstanders, and you can see this if you go up there, was to tell stories, Deb, across a number of different channels. So we had long-form version of these stories. We had video versions of these stories. We had podcast versions of these stories. They were 10 stories that had nothing to do with Starbucks. There's zero Starbucks branding anywhere in there. You won't find it. Trust me. We looked. We scoured. We paid attention. There is no branding. But what you will find are stories about amazing people doing really cool things in their communities. So you'll find a story about a Christian minister in Memphis who reached out to the new Islamic facility being built across the street to welcome them to Memphis because the minister was so concerned that that community may not welcome these new arrivals to Memphis.
Wow.
And what happened, which is really cool. I don't want to be the spoiler. Just go check that out. And there are many other stories like that. There's a former NFL guy, played for the Seahawks. He ended up having a pretty significant injury. He got addicted to pain meds, ended up in rehab. And when he got out, he started a gym facility, essentially getting other rehabbed athletes back on the field to play. But what the other thing that happened were the wounded warriors who were coming home from various fields of battle and really significantly challenged just to mainstream back into society again, started showing up. And when they showed up, a whole new stream of opportunity opened up for this guy. And he bagged the very lucrative business of getting athletes back in the field of play and started getting veterans back involved in life again. And so those are really interesting stories about humanity. And they go right back to the mission of the company. And so what we're trying to do, we're not trying to sell you coffee. It's cool that it happens. I think our shareholders are happy it happens. But we're trying to foster connections between someone in a green apron and someone standing across the plane from them every day. That's what we do.
That is so awesome. And as you gave that litany of channels and ways to tell that story, I think everyone in here should say, oh, wait, all that gateway training? That's my beginning to those kinds of careers, right? And even if I'm not the videographer, I understand that language because I did something in Gateway. Little Gateway shout out. It's one of our secret weapons, I do believe. And I saw the Wounded Warrior one. It was amazing. And I had no idea that it was part of your story. So I need to go back and look at that. So beautiful, beautiful work. Okay, Sir Bedbury. You are, you've built your career on being a game changer and as I said, a brand whisperer, which I really like that. I think you should put that into brand stream. You've told us what you're optimistic about, but I think how do we go back, and you spoke to this a little bit last night, how do we go back to the essentials of story and the essentials of purpose and make it real? What do we do there?
That's a really good question. I think real is a big word. I think advertising has suffered for 40 years along the way, just becoming less and less real. I mean, listen to a radio spot. I mean, how do they pick those voices? I mean, not to pick on anybody. But it's gotten so unhinged from reality. And I remember my daughter, Allie, she's a third-year pre-med here. She was in high school or something maybe 4 or 5 years ago. And my wife and I are watching TV. We're watching, like, network-fed TV. It wasn't being time-shifted or recorded or anything. And a commercial break comes on. I'm watching a Seahawks game or something. She goes, I can't believe you're doing this. What? You're watching commercials. It's like, okay, great. Thank you. That's kind of how I built my career. but I think there's been a degradation and a decline of integrity in a lot of things, and more recently our political system. And I think a lot of us in the industry own bits and pieces of this. Certainly journalists, advertising people, anybody that does tell a story, somewhere along the way we started taking shortcuts and started disrespecting people's intelligence. The time at which Nike struck on its own with Wyden early, I mean, this was 25, 30 years ago now, one of our fundamental beliefs was we would always respect the consumer's intelligence. Or as Jim Riswald once said to me, He came in with some concept once, and I couldn't approve it, and he hated that. He thought he could get anything approved. And he goes, "Don't you get it? You know, great creative is like two things, and you connect it, but you don't really connect it for somebody." I go, "Jim, what are you saying?" He goes, "You know, it's like two ends of a rope. You know, you never tie the knot for somebody. You let them tie the knot. You present the two ends of the rope. Create a tension, right? It's pretty fundamental." I looked at Jim and I said, "Well, I only see one end of rope here in this concept. You can show me the other one, we'll come back and have a conversation about it." So there's a higher level of intelligence in storytelling, and it's great. Starbucks is doing a phenomenal job, and it's doing it hand-to-hand combat, one-to-one between the barista and the consumer. And sometimes those conversations, those stories are the most powerful ones, right? It's not something slickly produced. So I just have always challenged myself to say, in the end of the day, if we did something, you know, whether it's a bit of content or an ad or whatever, did we make people think? Or did we go to the sixth grade mentality? Did we just go to the lowest common denominator? One of the best things I think a company can do is map the highest common denominators, not so much even common, the highest emotional territories that exist around your category. And obviously a coffee house is rife with it. You know, people, they don't usually go there just to drink a cup of coffee. To get their head together, you know, it's that little respite, that 8 minutes of whatever. And I said it a minute ago, if you can identify those higher territories, don't just speak to those, deliver those. Advertising has long since gone past the point at which it can position a company in some enduring way that it isn't. You know, it's at best, it's aspirational. It should reflect what is and not what you want it to be, the company, the brand. So I think a dose of authenticity, a dose of realism, show your warts, laugh at yourself. You guys are probably too young to remember a spot with Michael Jordan and Spike Lee where Spike is saying, you know, yo, it's got to be the shoes, right? He's rattling off all of Michael's achievements. And all the while, Michael's just shaking his head, no Mars, not that. And in the end, the title card comes up, classic White and Kennedy, and it said, "The views of Mr. Jordan don't necessarily reflect those of Nike Inc." So we were poking fun at marketing. We poked fun at sports marketing 20 some years ago. So don't take yourself too seriously. And I think there's a way here forward to create more meaning, more resonance, more relevancy in any little story you tell, no matter how you tell it. But in the end, look at it and say, "Am I proud of that? Is that the best I could do? And can you layer a couple other messages in there that maybe not everybody gets?" But maybe a group of consumers will look at that and go, "That's a very smart company. How did they know that?" Right? So try and communicate several things at once without driving yourself nuts. That makes sense?
Yeah, makes sense. We have, I'm official timekeeper. We have 20 minutes. I'd like to use 15 of those for student questions. And then 5 minutes, I'd like to bam, 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 each of you tell us one thing we should teach. You know, maybe this becomes a workshop, a seminar, a thing, but one thing that we should focus on teaching and learning here. So, moving to you guys, if you have a question, stand, tell us who you are and your question and who should address it. So, James, start us off.
What's up, James? I study advertising, like a lot of people who are. And, my question is directed to Glenn. By the way, your shirt says "No Problems," which is another symbol of optimism.
It's total marketing,
though, dude. I mean, I just thought I'd like point that out too, that since we're talking about optimism, but you're talking about personal brand, and where do you draw that line of like expressing yourself, like, and being in control of your voice, and then also like that professionalism line? We often talk about that a lot in
Like in our classes, like how we're developing ourselves on our social platforms, but how do you really go about that? How do I manage balancing my own voice or my own creative voice with a brand's voice? Like you're talking about like ourselves, like our own social media. Yeah, so the you meaning you. Yeah, yeah, personal brand. Like how do I go about that professional line versus being true to myself? Well, you should be true to yourself.
Right? I mean, just stay there. It doesn't mean like suddenly you have to whitewash your social channels or anything. I don't think. I think just be...
Unless you hotbox the puppy and then wipe him out. I'm just telling you right
now. You know,
now.
I think that why I'm weird having to build on that. You know, we're looking for values. I, at least, we are. I suspect most of the people at this table are also. You're looking for like, what's the value set of this person? What do they prioritize? I feel like a lot of the making stuff can be trained probably two ways now. For people who make really good vines, I'm like, how do you do that? That's really good stories in 6 seconds. But there's a lot of stuff you're going to step into where we have to train you. There's still some apprenticeship qualities in the business. But I'm looking more for values, and it's not like, does that person, you know, how profane are they, or how, what subject matter do they care about? And I think it's more like stay true to your values and what you're about, what you care about. Let it shine through. I'm looking for experimentation and bravery. And like, just, is there a new voice here emerging? And I think you just gotta do that. I think Scott has a great North Star. It's like, be the you that you're proud of. Do something you're proud of, and then that'll be the right answer. Now, whether that's the right answer for 72 and Sunny or for Wong Duty or somewhere else, that's, I think you can't be too hard on yourself, because these things, it's a relationship. So that doesn't mean you don't have the goods or we're.
So
we're
build the gut.
Hiring, it's like, it's a relationship. So you go on some dates, it works out. Some it doesn't, and it's a dance. So.
Yeah. Yay. Yeah, Kyle.
My name is Kyle, known as Riley, and my question is directed towards Glenn, Zach, and Tracy. Glenn brought up the point of some things being superficial, and Scott brought up the point of taking advantage of consumer intelligence, and Tracy's all about creativity. So how would you define an ad campaign or a commercial as being superficial or taking advantage of the public?
Scott, Tracy.
Yeah. Yeah, insert political commercial here. I mean, choosing parties in that one. Superficial to me is a complete failure to really work hard enough to make something resonate. And it's hard to make something resonate with everyone. That's really hard. And I think when you do it, you know it when you feel it, right? The dangers of superficial, here's what drives superficiality. Being risk averse, not wanting to take a stand on something. Because by the way, 5% of humanity is crazy. They will never like what you do. If you try and please everyone, you'll go out of business. If you think the consumer's right, have them set your salary. See how far that goes. So I think you just really need to think about what's right and true and stick with that. But I think when we give up little by little, suddenly we lose the edge. And I'm not a big fan, and I know there's a lot of folks here, even on the panel, that do pre-test creative stuff. As I said last night, we never did that at Nike. And I think if you have no idea what you're doing, then you probably should pre-test what you created. Save yourself some horror. But hopefully you should know what you're doing. And the problem with creatives is most people, and Steve Jobs would echo this, I'm sure, they're not comfortable with things they haven't seen before. And that's the nature of innovation, that you're doing something that hasn't quite been thrown together before. And when people are uncomfortable with that, and if you listen to them say, oh my God, that woman over there, she's uncomfortable with that, I can't do that. You will little by little create what I call perfectly unremarkable communication. It's perfect in its unremarkability. So I think having some edge, having some courage and conviction will minimize superficiality.
Drop that mic, yeah. Man, right there. Sorry. Do it, yeah. Yeah. Agreed. Tracy.
Well, on that, I'll throw in something on it. I think you need to be, when you guys are, I don't know if you're looking for, like, when you're writing your own campaigns, how do you make sure you're not doing something inauthentic, or is that what's behind that question? Like, I think you guys' job is to be the biggest bullshit detectors you can be. It's really hard when you're coming up with something, by the way, to be your own bullshit detector. That's why it helps to have a partner, or I think get things on the wall, or get things in public, I should say. It doesn't have to be a wall. But that's really your job. And that's because, as Scott said, at the end of the day, it's about authenticity. And to me, that means, do I feel a genuine connection with this brand? And I just look at the brand as a person. Do I actually feel like there's a connection after I just had experienced that campaign? Or do I just feel like talked at? It's really, I feel like it's really basic that way. It's like, I like that person, or I like that brand, or I feel something. If you don't, it's probably inauthentic, Bullshit. Alarm's going off. Move on to something else.
And nothing to add.
Yay.
Hey, Deb, I'll add one little bit, even though you didn't ask. I'll say it anyway. So thanks for that.
So I'm kind of seizing on something Glenn said. You know, I think one thing I've heard Howard say like 1,000 times, if he's said it once, is that we exist to make our people proud. And so we still don't test a damn thing. We test nothing. But what we do is we have a robust, ongoing dialogue in both private and public forums with 175,000 people who wear the green apron in this country alone, not to mention the rest of the world. It's like 330,000. And so to me, the best bullshit detector that our company has is the do you make your people proud litmus test. And we know it, right? I mean, I realize this is a pretty flimsy or sort of liquid statement. You know, make your people proud. What does that mean? But it's not existential. I mean, it is a very real thing. I mean, you know whether you are doing something, whether you are taking an action, making a statement that is in line with your mission, your purpose, your values, the things that, you know, why do your people show up every day? So if you're doing something that countermands why your people show up every day, then it's the worst kind of superficial. Why do it? It's a waste. And it denigrates the brand, exactly what Scott said. And so I think in today's day and age, there is a very inner lens that you have to sort of put on this. And I think that applies both at the agency level, where they're thinking about a lot of different clients and sort of what do they want to stand for. And, you know, for folks like us that are in-house at the, you know, how do we show up every day? If this thing is garbage, no. And that's the job. It's to argue garbage off the ledge, kill garbage. That's the job.
I love it. Yes. And get gut in there. Yes, ma'am. And that was not a plan, by the way, but I appreciate that question. Thank you.
I'll jump in quickly. To the extent stories are important and storytelling is timeless, been around since cavemen around a fire, it's how we pass culture, it's how we pass knowledge. Some stories are more important than others, and I happen to believe personally, not because I grew up in Eugene and I had my hippie years, I honestly think the environment is probably one of the most important stories we have got to tell. I met the woman that's Al Gore's chief environmental advisor for the last 20 years, or she said, since the hanging chad. So that would be back in Florida, whenever that would have been. And she goes, the challenge that we have right now is we haven't made the environment personal. It's about some ocean, it's about Antarctica, it's some ice shelf, it's some rise in numbers, you know. And if you reject science, forget it. I mean, that's going to be tough, right? I think we have collectively failed at that. And I would encourage everyone to think about how we tell that story professionally, personally. If we see someone that is really not just being egregious in their behaviors, but actually just being an idiot, you know, set them straight. I think it's not just for your good, but for your kids and the next one. So,
yeah,
very important question.
Tracy, yeah.
Okay, so I actually talked to Al Gore. I cornered in some kind of a Democratic thing, and I asked him a question. I said, help me to understand why this is so difficult. And he said, well, the problem is, it's like he had to do a whole movie to explain it, right? He said, with that problem, it starts with the head and moves down to the heart. When it gets to the heart, then you'll do something. He says, the hard part is it starts here, and it really has a hard time moving down. He says, if there's a snake under the table, it goes right to my heart. Holy shit, I have to get out of here. So that really is the mechanism that we're dealing with. He says, I don't know how we do this yet. He said to me, it's like he just threw his arms up. That's the problem. Yeah. It needs to go this way. You need to go right here. So yeah. How do you personalize that story? It's a big story. People can't even get their hands around. Well, a lot of people don't even believe it. That's crazy. So yeah. That's the problem. You guys figure it out.
We're doing some amazing work around that and amazing
right
questions around that.
Go through here.
Right.
Go through here.
Yeah, I'm going to use that. And I'll give you some attribution, but
no,
I'll also
just give it to Al. He needs it.
Another question. Emma.
My question's for Dana. So you talked a lot about big data, and how are you using that to fuel your own creativity and also help the creativity of others?
It's interesting because there's a lot of conversation going on in many agencies about whether or not data is creativity, or even if it plays a part in the creative process. There are creative people who say, no, get it away from me. And all it is about numbers and stats and all that kind of unuseful stuff. But the important thing about data and what we have to do with data, and it's completely counterintuitive to people who are just like totally quant focused, is we have to tell stories with data. That's the most important thing that we can do. If we're using data to define a customer based on their communications behavior, based on their purchase behavior, based on their purchase intent, we need to create what that persona is, right? So it has resonance, not only to our internal staffs and to creative individuals, but also to our clients, right? They have to understand that this data paints an opportunity to reach a customer in a specific way, at a specific time, at a point that's meaningful for them along a purchase journey. And importantly, with a message, this is why creativity is so important, but with a message that really gets them to respond and to react. And that traditionally has been advertising-like things. I think more and more and more, as clients kind of wrap their heads around what content could be and what it should be as a part of the brand message, it'll be more and more about content. And I think that's a really, really important shift. If you guys are spending a whole bunch of time trying to craft an ad, I would say spend more time trying to imagine what content can be, how it fits with brands, and then using data really to help drive and point those or understand where those points of creativity could actually happen. I have creative people running from me now, and I say, no, come back. We need a big idea. We need you to help us bring this to life. So the collaboration in agencies is going to come like fast and furiously, especially when you start thinking about stuff like dynamic content, which is so ultimately cool. It doesn't put Tracy out of business, or my friend over here, Glenn, doesn't put anybody out of business, but it just requires a different kind of thinking and a much more iterative thought process.
There's a lot of fear around it. There's a lot of fear around it, but I think I can't get enough of it. And I think it's just it's like Tracy said, it's a tool. What you do with it, right? That's our job.
I think Dana's right? being too humble. I think her magic is the ability as for you strategists out there as how to turn it into something usable.
That's
so
right.
It's like I gave a speech at a big data conference thing, marketing thing, and the quote I used was, "We're drowning in a sea of information and we're starving for wisdom." Mm-hmm. So the issue is you've got to take this and make it into something. That's the magic of strategy. That is the magic. It's like you can hand me something like, oh, I can work with that. It's when you see this stuff, it's like, oh, I don't know what that is. So.
But I have to tell you, I'm not a strategist. Mm. I'm an account person wearing a strategy and big data hat.
But I think you're
the
poster woman for hybrid, right?
Well,
so you're management, but you're a strategist.
I'm about to go right down that path.
Yeah.
Because we've talked a lot about storytelling, but storytelling also need somebody to help translate that, right, and sell it to a client.
Mm-hmm. Well, bring it down to your own experience, too. Think about what data visualization can do. Mm-hmm. Think about what a good infographic does for you. It draws you into data and tells a story and does it in a way that's very approachable. Mm-hmm. So think about just even bringing this down to scale with what you're doing.
We're pushing data and design together in some places just to, you know, to let it play. So
how many quantitatively oriented people do we have in the room?
We're in journalism because we don't do that.
I think it's more than what they're, we end up dealing with, have I taken that class, rather than am I thinking in those terms?
You have to think that way. For me, it's all about perspective, right? You have to have a perspective around who the customer is, who the brand is, not what the brand is, who the brand is, and how it interacts, and how people interact with it. That is both a qualitative and intuitive process, but it also has a quantitative and data-driven strategy process to it as well. So, cool stuff.
So, I'm looking at time. We have 3 minutes, and so we're going to go bam, 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 bam. What should we teach and learn here?
You got to start that in this time.
Okay. Tracy.
God. I have to say, based on what I've seen, it's like, you guys are doing a great job. If I could say one thing without having been in all the classes, presentation skills.
Presentation
getting
skills.
Getting out in front and presenting and art making your case.
Agreed. Write these down.
More.
Yeah. Teach and learn.
What should you teach? Okay, a couple data points and then the closer. More content has been uploaded to YouTube in the last 60 days than the major three networks created in 60 years. 60 years. Point one. Facebook alone, 4 billion streams a day. A day. Last point. When we do surveys about the news, less than 33% of people in this country trust the news. They don't trust it. And they have a lot of good reasons, and Scott basically said all of them before, so I'm not going to recount them here. So what I would teach, Deb, is radical transparency, because the world that we live in today is both no one trusts the news, everybody is a reporter, everyone's a reporter, everybody's got the ability to transmit something, and they're doing it with alarming frequency. And so as a brand, as a company, as an organization moving around in the world, you not only have to get comfortable with the idea that you're naked, alone, and on a stage with a big old light on you, you gotta learn to dance while that's happening.
Bam. Scott?
A couple quick things. I think there is a lot of adversity out there, and I think teaching you guys or finding ways to understand how to overcome adversity. How have other people overcome adversity? There was a time at Starbucks when our budgets got cut. Shortly after I got there, I think the marketing budget at Nike was $800 million. The marketing budget at Starbucks was $3 million. And I had like a 20% cut to my department overhead. I was like, what the hell? I'd been there maybe 3 months. So one of my people, I can't remember who, we decided to throw a bake sale. So on the 8th floor of the Soto building,
I remember that.
Was your idea. We actually, all the execs, all the employees came off the 8th floor, and there we were with our tables and our cookies. And honestly, I picked mine up at Safeway. Yours were amazing. And it's like, we're raising money for the marketing department. And it's like, what? And so I took this bag of money, mostly coins and dollar bills, to Orrin Smith's office. Our CFO at the time was one of those real black cap guys. Everything's bad. And I said, it's a little bit, it's $234, but we're doing what we can here. The point is, that's...
that idea for that. Howard, bake sale. Do it now.
It showed resilience. It showed creativity. It showed that our team was a team, and we're having fun in the face of all that. So I would definitely make a point of that. And the last thing, this one should be trademarked. Maybe somebody's already done it. Be more selfie less. I think every time we take a selfie of just ourselves, it's a nick on our soul.
There you go.
Honestly.
That'll be on the final, for real.
Wow. What happens when we do like a group one, Scott?
Yeah.
Soul sucked straight off the panel.
But to Corey's point, we're storytellers. What stories are we telling, right? So I just encourage you to think about that. Think about other people.
Perfect. Dana?
I would say a couple things. One, I would say resist the average. If you look at our country, you look at all the people in it, most people are average. It's true. Most people are not rock stars. And so I think you have to resist that. When you have moments, and there will be many, many moments in your career when you have to make a decision about whether or not you're going to do what everyone else is doing, or if you're going to strike out on your own with a point of view that makes absolute sense to you that you believe wholeheartedly. Follow that path. Do not divert from it ever. Because if you do, you will be in the sea of average. Average never got anybody anywhere. It never created an opportunity for anyone. It allowed you to exist, nice and maybe even comfortably. But don't do it. The other thing is read. We talk about writing. We talked about sort of that being an important part of your curriculum here. But I would say read. One of the biggest issues we have in this country is that people are 1,000% consuming information, but they're not reading for themselves and forming their own points of view. Ergo, our election cycle. You wouldn't know if something someone said was true or not true unless you investigated and read it for yourself. And most of the stuff, thank God we're in the era of technology, is posted. So you'll know whether or not, and some people are caught on video saying it. And so you know it's true because you saw it come from their mouth, right? Don't be deceived. If it walks like a duck, if it quacks like a duck, guess what it is? A duck. Believe it and own it and trust yourselves. And when you get into these organizations, don't be the 20-year-old who shows up and sort of hangs in the back of the room, not sure of where your place is. You have a place at the table. You have a voice at the table. So use it. If you don't use it, it falls to the shelf somewhere. Nobody understands where you are, what you think, how you think, what you care about. And we need that. We need people who are informed. We need people who care. We need people who understand, have some intellectual ability, people who are fearless about taking risks. Do all that, and I promise you, you will be going against the tide. So know it now. I spent most of my career going against the tide. But do it. I got to tell you, it's the most fun I've ever had. I'm having so much fun right now.
Beautiful. So fearless.
Rich, she's not talking about you. It's cool to be in the back row in this room. It's good.
Pat.
Okay, I'm the one thing that's not like the other up here, so let me try this from a slightly different tack. And it's going to build beautifully off what Dan just said, which is, you've heard this a lot up here, have fun. If you're not having fun while you're in college, for heaven's sake, you'll never have fun. And I gotta tell you, I had a lot of fun as a college student. My grades reflected that, okay?
And that was in religion and philosophy.
And at the end of my freshman year, I made the dean of students list for students you'd most like to see not come back the next year. That is also a true story. So, have fun.
Yeah.
And have fun every day that you go into work. Those who know my office know I keep the Ben Jerry's bumper sticker in there. If it's not fun, why do it? And that is the motto I live by. So, keep it fun. Having said that, I'm now, you know, I fed you the chocolate cake. I'm going to give you a little bit of broccoli. And that is, don't become too tool obsessive and technology obsessive. I came out and walked into my first professional position, and I was a whiz at Scripsit. Anybody even heard of it? I do believe I'm older than anybody else on this panel. Then I had to become a whiz at WordPerfect. Then PageMaker. Okay, understand. That's all going to change. So when we tell you, yeah, you really need to take media history, you really need to have those conceptual courses, understand it's like reading. It's what gives you that great background to really put your ideas into and think about. And so realize we're trying to give you that balance of concepts and tools that are really going to get you going out there.
Glenn,
amen.
We got to be quick.
Have fun. Okay. Sorry, I'm going to bring the plane down a little bit. Thank you for taking it up. As far as like a class, a thing we should teach, I feel like, you know, what I was going to say, Pat sort of got me rethinking. That's why I'm stuttering here. But, look, I think the world is just moving fast. It's going to move faster. And someday, 10 years from now, one of you guys or several of you is going to be up here talking to another set of students, and you're going to be saying something like, man, it moves so fast now. I mean, when I was in school, blah, blah, it seemed like, you know, it was kind of manageable, which to me, anyway, is almost crazy. It's almost, the world moves so fast, I struggle to keep up, I feel like. Keep big data as a helpful tool. But I think, you know, one thing I think would help to learn, and I want to separate this from, it's not about the technologies, but learning to make things at the speed of culture or the world is really important. And it is a skill that probably you're going to be teaching your employer more than your employer is going to be teaching you. So I would, whether you call it social making or high tempo making, teaching yourself to be adaptable, responsive, intuitive, instinctive, figuring out what your instincts even are helps. It comes a lot easier when you're making stuff fast. Make stuff, a brief that has to be answered in hours, you know? Not days. I think that'd be cool. Until then, you know, I recommend you join a creators network. Do something that forces you to just make all the time, and that'll take care of a lot of it as far as your voice and your social networks and all that other stuff. Make flex, and by
for the love of God, have fun doing it.
That's right. The event planner is going to me out there, and I just told her that we're going to stay in here 2 more hours, and she said, no, I can't do it. A couple of things. I would encourage everyone to put your 2 best takeaways on Twitter, and let's hashtag it. What is it? SOJC 100.
Whatever platform you like using.
Yeah.
Vine.
Right, or Vine. But do it quickly there, right? I want to say thank you. Amazing, guys. Amazing. I think we'll wait. Right. I know that we're going to have to move out in there, and I know that you're going to want to talk. Do that. Thank you so much. Thank you, Tim, for putting all this together. Amy, wow. Thank you. Guys, that was amazing.